Baptist Church. Delighted that you're here today. This is the first Sunday of the month, therefore we will be celebrating communion. Please make sure that you picked up the elements on the way in because you will need them at that time later. Couple of announcements that will keep us all on the same page for this week. This evening at 5:30, we will be having our first Sunday night family night. That's a ministry primarily designed for our children, but we are encouraging the family to come together to that. We also are in need of some volunteers, so I trust that you will consider being with us tonight, 5:30 to 6:30, to participate in the Sunday night family night. Next week, as you know, this is by the flags hanging in here, we are in October, which has historically been our missions month. We are looking forward to having the Blazers with us, their missionaries to Brazil. Tonight, we will be speaking at both morning services, and they're staying through the day, and they will be here for the family night on Sunday night as well. So we're looking forward to that. To do the best of correction in the bulletin regarding the Haitian folks, the bulletin says that they are attending Grace Lake Baptist, that is incorrect. They are Grace Hispanic Baptist Church. Pastor Pepe has been ministering to these folks. And a number of us have noticed that the weather has changed quite a bit. And a few people were talking this morning about it being cold. Well, imagine if you were from Haiti. It is really cold. So they're looking for some warm clothing. And if you would be able to help with that, your participation would be appreciated. Patsy Beecham is overseeing that. So if you have questions, you can talk to Patsy. In addition to jackets and warm clothing, blankets would be helpful. There's an announcement in there regarding the bond issue here. At First Baptist Church, Gordon says a number of folks have approached them already. We appreciate that. Thanks to those who were part of the work day yesterday. Lots of things were accomplished. We are grateful for that. Grateful for safety. You notice that some of the concrete has been poured for the floors. We are looking forward to completing that project. As we go to prayer, a couple of things to thank the Lord for. Dave Webster reported that the results of his heart cath on Monday were good. There are no additional problems. He still has the need for open heart surgery, but there's no additional issues that they found. He has a follow-up appointment on the 16th of this month, and then he will also meet with a surgeon. So we want to continue to pray for Dave and Luella. Steve Arcello is feeling good. He's been back at work doing light duty. He has another procedure on Wednesday. And Lord willing, this is going to get him back to where he was when he's having a stent replaced about every 8 weeks. But that seems to be very, very helpful in helping him function well. So we want to pray for Steve, grateful for how he's doing. Carolina's mom has an appointment tomorrow. So we want to pray that that goes well for her. Julie Dykeman again was here. After the last service, she has a few more radiation treatments, and she continues to go to work. She's grateful for the Lord's grace in giving her health and strength, and she has some additional tests and things to go through, so we want to continue to pray for Julie. Tim Hepworth, like also a missionary that we support, has had some heart issues, so we want to be praying for them as well. Now, before I pray, we're going to do something that is somewhat unusual because normally we would do this at the end of the service, but we're not going to do anything that is normal. This is from our covenant here at First Baptist Church, and it says this: any person who has accepted Jesus Christ as personal Savior, getting evidence of the new birth, having been baptized by immersion, and expressing a desire and willingness to be a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ will be received as members of this local church. I'd like Greg and Melissa Church, if you would please stand. Normally, we would like them to come forward, but we're not doing that this morning. Greg and Melissa have been attending First Baptist for just about a year. They've lived with their six children in North Muskegon. Greg certainly has a gift of teaching, and Melissa a gift of hospitality. They have expressed a desire to bring a vessel to become members of First Baptist Church. And all who would join me in receiving this couple, would you signify with a hearty amen? Thank you. Let me see. typically we would accept the right hand of fellowship because that's what we do, but in the days of COVID, we're not going to do that. But if you don't know Grant, unless they take the opportunity to get to know them, they're their family of fantastic folks, and we are delighted that they choose it to make First Baptist Church their home. Will you pray with me? This morning we come into your presence and we are grateful that we can. Your word tells us to come boldly, to think that we are entering the throne, that we are coming before the mercy seat. God, because we need your mercy, and we know your word tells us that we will find grace to help at just the time we need it. Lord, we thank you for the fact that you are a faithful God. The fact that it's cold this morning reminds us of changing seasons. They change because you promised that they will change. Father, we're so grateful to know that you are still on the throne. You are in control. We've been praying for our friend Steve Upsell for a long time, and Lord, we are grateful that he is feeling good enough to be back to work, good enough to be eating solid food. Father, we want to commit him into your hands as he has a procedure again on Wednesday. Father, our desire is that receiving the stent being placed properly will be exactly what needs to happen for him. Lord, we rejoice with this person that his right path was pumped good and did not reveal additional problems. So we receive that as a gift from you. We do realize, though, he is in need of serious surgery, so we commit him to you, asking that the appointments on the 16th would go well. Lord, for all of the treatments that Julie has received, to think that she's been strong enough to continue to work, able to be worshiping with her brothers and sisters in Christ, Father, we thank you for that. Would ask that as she has her last few radiation treatments and then further testing, that you would be pleased to apply the markers to do what they need to be so that she can continue to be treated for her cancer. We also want to pray for Diana's niece, Dawn. We don't even know all of the details here this morning, Lord, but we don't need to because you do. You know exactly where she is. You know exactly what her condition is. You know what your plan for her life is. And Lord, we recognize that sometimes our faith is weak. When your son Jesus was on this earth, he could think a thought, he could say a word, or someone could touch his clothing and be healed. And we believe and we trust that you have the power for all of these folks who have health needs. You have the power. But sometimes your decision, your choice, is to have them face a difficult trial. We're reminded that your word tells us that the trials that we face here on earth are nothing compared to the weight of glory that awaits us. So remind us of these things. Give us comfort with these things. Pray for Carolina's mom that her appointment tomorrow goes well. And Lord, for the things that you're accomplishing here in the life of First Baptist Church, the work day, safety on the job site, the progress on the building, the finances that you've been providing, all in for family who has identified First Baptist Church as their local church. We thank you. Help us to be a local church that seeks to honor and glorify the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, in all that we do. to focus only on the person and work of your Son. As we worship this morning, we want our worship to be acceptable to you. Father, give us opportunity to examine our hearts. Make sure that we are right with you, right with each other. And after we examine ourselves, your word says that we ought to eat, which we won't eat because you, our marvelous Savior, we confess that we love you. We invite you to be a part of every aspect of this service. We pray in the precious name of your Son. Now we've completed our study in the book of Nehemiah. Because we're in Missions Month, we will have a couple of guest speakers. So for a couple of weeks in October this week, and 2 weeks from now, and perhaps a few Sundays in November, we'll be doing some one-off messages that won't be in a particular book, and then we will start an indoor study unless we start Christmas early. We'll see what happens. But I invite you this morning to turn to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Every time we gather as a local church to remember the Lord, it never ceases to amaze me to think about the fact that we are doing something in response to the direct command of the Lord Jesus. The Gospels tell us that when Jesus was with his disciples at the Last Supper, he took some bread, gave thanks for it, and as he passed it to his disciples, he told them to take some and to eat it. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." That same supper, he took the cup, and he told them that the cup represented his blood, the blood of the new covenant. And as he instructed the disciples to drink from the cup, he again said, "Do this in remembrance of me." And when Paul repeats this command of the Lord Jesus in 1 Corinthians 11, he also says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Paul understood that we indeed this morning, as followers of the Lord Jesus, have something to proclaim. We have someone to proclaim. He also reminds us that that proclamation isn't something that we're always going to do. Jesus is coming back. And someday we'll be with him, and we won't need these symbols to remind us of what he's done. The idea of proclaiming, to proclaim means to announce publicly, typically, insistently, and proudly. We took a look for just a moment last week at 1 Peter chapter 9 that says this: "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, and people for God's own possession, so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." And I wonder this morning, are you prepared? Are you gathered? Is your heart ready to worship? Are we ready to proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light? Peter goes on to say, "For you once were not a people, but now you are the people of God. You have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." This morning, as we look at Philippians chapter 2, we will both proclaim the death of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, but we will also proclaim the excellencies of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. You have your Bibles open, Philippians chapter 2, beginning with verse 5. "Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him, and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The title of the message this morning is The Steps of Jesus. And as we begin to think about the steps of Jesus, I want us to look first at the starting point. The starting point. Notice what Paul writes in verse 6. Who, although he existed in the form of God. The starting point for us this morning is to understand the deity of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that he existed in the form of God, which means he possessed the appearance of God and the very being of God. Jesus was and is God. John writes in the Gospel of John, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. I love how the author of Hebrews introduces us to our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. In Hebrews chapter 1, writing about Jesus, the author of Hebrews says this: God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets, in many portions and in many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the world. And he is the radiance of his glory, and the exact representation of his nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power. God is speaking of the Son, speaking to the Son in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8, says this: But of the Son he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever, and the righteous scepter is the scepter of his kingdom. So that's the beginning, that's the starting point. That tells us who our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, is, the second member of the Godhead. God himself. Yet what we're going to learn this morning is that the Lord Jesus, in order to be our Savior, was willing to take multiple steps down. So let's think about that for a moment. What are the steps down that Jesus took? Verse 6 again, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped. That has the idea of holding on to, clinging to. This is who he was. This is who he is. The Lord Jesus did not insist on clinging to that essence, to that form. Notice what happens. Verse 7. But he emptied himself. He emptied himself. You might have, like the King James that says he made himself of no reputation, or the NIV that says he made himself nothing. This means that Jesus was willing to divest himself of his own personal interests. This is who he is. was willing to set them. Why is it necessary? What was his concern? What would cause the Lord Jesus Christ to be willing to take that step? You think in the Old Testament economy, there would be something that you would see happen day after day after day. Someone who is far better in math than I am should someday maybe try to figure out how many animals died in a Levitical sacrificial system. Lamb after lamb, goat after goat, bull after bull, would have their throats slit so that their blood could flow out, so that they could be burned on the altar for various and sundry things. But you know what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10? It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin. All of those sacrifices, year after year, battle after battle, animal after animal, it is impossible for all of that blood to take away sin. The author of Hebrews in that same passage says this: therefore, since it is impossible for that blood to take away sins, therefore, because of that, when he, Jesus, comes into the world, he says, sacrifice and offering you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In open offerings and sacrifices for sin you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come in the scroll of the book it is written of me to do your will, O God. So let me give you just one example of what Paul means when he says, Jesus did not regard the quality with God a thing to be graced, but he emptied himself. They spent much time thinking about the glory of God. There's a popular song I can only imagine. Thinking about what it's going to be like when we step into heaven's glory. Getting much thought of what it must be like, what it would be like to see God in all of his glory. My guess is you haven't. You want to know why? Because we can't have it. In fact, the Bible says in John chapter 1, verse 18, no one has seen God at any time. No one has ever seen God in all of his glory. Now, when Jesus says in John 14, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, what it means is we've seen the nature of God. But when no human beings have not seen the fullness of the glory of God. That's why God said to Moses in Exodus chapter 33, you cannot see my face, for no man can see me and live. Again, what is God saying? You can't handle my glory. It's beyond your ability to take it. Again, we don't think about this very often, but perhaps you remember Exodus chapter 19 when God is giving the law to the children of Israel. There God is, he's on Mount Sinai. The text of Scripture says this: all the people perceive the thunder and the lightning flashes and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking. When all the people saw it, they trembled and stood in the distance. Then they said to Moses, speak to us yourself and we will listen, but let not God speak to us or we will die. God had been speaking the words of the law, and the children of Israel recognized, and you keep speaking. We cannot handle the presence of God. We cannot handle the holiness of God. We cannot handle the glory of God. Do you remember in Exodus chapter 34 when Moses finally gets the words of the law written on the tablets written by the finger of God, and it comes down off of the mountain? crying over his face. Why? Because that's the glory of God. We get a little picture of it in the life of the Lord Jesus, who was willing to empty himself. Can you imagine? The Lord Jesus, who is fully God, he is willing to empty himself to come to this earth. But he's being arrested in John chapter 18. Jesus asks the people who are there, "Who do you seek?" They say, "Jesus the Nazarene." And he said to them, "I am he." Do you remember what happened? He was told them, just the words that Jesus speaks. It was a little glimpse of who he was, a little glimpse of his glory. And they felt that. Dr. Robert Wagner, Dallas Theological Seminary, puts it this way: "The possessing full deity, Jesus did not consider his equality with God as something to be held on to." In other words, Christ did not hesitate to set aside his self-willed use of deity when he became a man. As God, he had all the rights of deity, and during his incarnate state, he surrendered his right to manifest himself visibly as the God of all splendor. We think about the 12 disciples hanging out with Jesus, walking with Jesus, and talking with Jesus. That's because he humbled himself. That's because he emptied himself. Listen to another step that Jesus took. He emptied himself, verse 7 says, taking the form of a bondservant. This is Jesus, the second member of the Godhead, the agent of creation. What is it that the author of Hebrews said about him? He is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power. This Jesus, instead, said, "I am willing to become a servant." He said to his disciples, "Even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve." I don't know about any of you, but I sometimes have a problem wanting to be a servant. Do you know who I am? I stay wherever they say. I don't want to be a servant. This is the Son of God. God Himself. Who says, "I'm going to step down because my interests are nearly as important as your interests." When this communion supper was instituted at the Last Supper, there's an account in John chapter 13. Do you know what the disciples were talking about right before they get to the upper room? That's a question of course. Anybody know? What are they talking about? Who's the greatest? Now, I don't think. Did you hear that sermon I preached last week? Have you ever heard a better sermon than that? Did you see the miracle I performed? I mean, the lightning came out of my finger like 7 feet. Did you see that? I have accomplished all these things. I'm sure I'm going to be the greatest. No, I'm going to be the greatest. No, I'm even better. So the disciples are going to the Last Supper. And the number one thing on their mind was, who is the greatest? Now, when they get there, something is desperately wrong. You realize they walked on dirt road until they wore sandals and their feet would have been filthy. So it was a cultural practice. It was a common practice that when you went into someone's home, especially if you were going to eat, that the lowest slave, the lowest person on the totem pole, would wash your feet. Except for the Lord Jesus and his disciples, everyone would have known that something was desperately wrong. As they were reclining at the table, everyone would have known something was something was missing. It would be much like if you invited, if someone invited you to their house for a meal, but there were no chairs at the table. I mean, the table's all set, and the food's on the table, but there are no chairs. What are you going to be thinking? You're going to be thinking to yourself, where are we going to sit? Where are the chairs? This is when something's wrong. All of those disciples knew something was wrong. They all knew they were sitting down at their feet. They were probably wondering, who's going to take care of the dirty, rotten feet? Not all of them. Who is it? The Son of God. The agent of creation. The one who upholds all things by the word of his power. He is the one who gets up from his place at the table, puts a towel around his waist, and he watches the disciples. The text goes on to say, and being made in the likeness of men. Jesus was and is fully God, and he also was and is fully human. He was able to fully participate in all of human experience. Jesus understands what it is to need food, to be hungry, to be tired, and need rest, to be thirsty, to feel pain. In his humanity, in his human body, limited to being only one place at a time. Yet we need to understand that while Jesus was truly a man, he was not merely a man, because he is also God. Now, as human beings, we think that being human makes us all that. We think we're at the top of the food chain. But we read Psalm 8 or Hebrews chapter 2, we find out that it is not necessarily the case. Verse 8 says, being found in appearance as a man, and yet he was truly human. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point. Tell you that there are truths that the Bible teaches that are hard for me to grasp. The hypostatic union is one of those, the fact that the Lord Jesus is fully God and fully man. I have a hard time wrapping my brain around that. But the Bible says it's true. The Bible says that Jesus humbled himself. That's an important distinction to make. Have you ever been humbled? Has anyone ever taken you down a peg or two? That's not a fun place to be, but that's not what happened to Jesus. He humbled himself. Now, as God, the Lord Jesus didn't need to humble himself because he was humble. But as man, Jesus makes the volitional choice to set aside his own interests for ours, to be willing to be a bondservant, to choose to be a bondservant, to choose to be a man, to be willing to humble himself in obedience to the point of death. Do you understand that Jesus did not demand his rights? What rights would Jesus have asked God? I sometimes chuckle when I'm reading the Gospels, and I wonder how he would question Jesus. What sign do you do? And I sometimes wish that the Lord would have just said, oh, I hold all things by the word of my power. I'll just kind of unhold them for a second. You want to see a sign? Just exploded. How's that work for you? Of course, he wouldn't do that. because he was without sin. Never once. Even when he's standing before Pilate, and Pilate says, I find no fault in him. He just said, that's it. The word is him. Yet he was willing to humble himself, to become obedient. Stepping down, knew that he's coming to earth to die. But does he go further step? Even death. Perhaps you've watched a movie that included the samurai or Roman soldiers. The samurai who want an honorable death. The soldiers who want a soldier's death. Or a merciful death. Jesus got none of those. He didn't get honorable death. He didn't get merciful death. He did not get a quick death. He got so far removed from crucifixion, we read those words and they are void of much meaning. But understand that the Romans created, invented crucifixion to be the most horrible, most painful, most awful death reserved for the worst offenders. Roman citizens themselves were not to be crucified. Only the really, 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 really dead people. And as such, Jesus was cursed by man. Not only are we going to execute you, we are going to execute you in the worst way possible. But also recognizing being willing to step down to the point of death, even death on a cross, Jesus was being cursed by God himself. Galatians chapter 3 says, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. But then Deuteronomy 21:23 says, for he who is hanged is accursed by God. Have you pictured in your mind the scene in the Garden of Gethsemane? Jesus, who existed in the form of God, who had the very essence of God, who is God, who created the universe, the radiance of his glory, the exact representation of his nature, he is willing to step down and step down and step down, humbling himself to the point of death, even death on a cross. Did you see the Lord Jesus there in the Garden of Gethsemane? Can you hear him say, my soul is deeply grieved to the point of death? Can you hear him cry out to the Father, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but thine be done. A few verses later, in Luke 22, and being in agony, he was praying very fervently, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling down upon the ground. Because of your sin, because of my sin, because of your interest, because of my interest, Jesus was willing to step down, step down, step down, step down. You know, if the passage ended there, it would be really depressing. But we this morning proclaim the death of our Savior, the Lord Jesus, who was willing to step. first night. And for a moment or two, we get to change the direction. We get to see the steps of Jesus as he steps out and steps out and steps out. Verse 9, for this reason also. What's the reason? His humility, which leads to his obedience. For this reason also, God highly exalted him. Who does the exalting? Who is the cause of the exaltation? God himself. John MacArthur writes that there are four elements to the exaltation of Jesus Christ. One being resurrection. In Acts chapter 2, verse 32 and 33, Peter is preaching and he says, this Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God. Even the form of God does not consider equality with God something to be graced. But he acts as himself. And he steps down and down and down to the worst possible death. He can't get any lower. But what does God do? He raises him up to the right hand of the Father. You realize that you can't get any higher. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. MacArthur says, the ascension of Jesus is a part of his exaltation. In Hebrews 4:14, we read, since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens. Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. A third element to the exaltation of Jesus Christ is his coronation. A great prayer from Ephesians chapter 1, talking about the power that God is willing to make available to you and to me. Paul writes, it's the same power which he brought about in Christ when he raised him from the dead. And seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he has put all things in subjection under his feet and gave him his head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Maybe like many of you on Tuesday night, I watched the presidential debate, or at least I watched some of the presidential debate. There are so much more to take. To men who are fighting to occupy the highest office of the land, some people would argue the most powerful person. Disaster, the gentleman preferred. The president has COVID-19. That's not the first lady. A number of people that are in the inner circle. What's going to happen? I trust that we're praying for the president and the Speaker of the House, like God's word calls us to. But we spend tons of time worrying and fretting and wondering and thinking. Oh, the election's a month away. What's going to happen when we wake up the next morning and our candidate wins or loses? Do you know who Jesus is this morning? I don't know if you. We pretend we do. But do we know? Do we understand that Jesus is seated at his right hand in the heavenly places, expectation of the Lord Jesus Christ is his intercession. Listen to what Hebrews 7:25 says. Hence also, he is able to save forever those who draw near to God through faith, since he always waits to make intercession for them. Do you know where Jesus is right now? He's at the right hand of the Father. He's been crowned king. And as he sits there, he is praying for you and he's praying for me. Because when Steve messes up, sometimes we think about God being, you know, scared with bone, and you step out of line. You got money in your shoes. Yeah, there's a lightning bolt because I'm going to get you. That's not what God is. Because it's the right hand of the Father, it's King Jesus, who is the propitiation for our sin, who reminds the Father and I pay for that sin. Step up and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. We already know about the power in the name of the Lord Jesus, Acts 4:12, and the salvation of no one else. There is no other name under heaven that's been given among men by which we must be saved. And we know that Scriptures give multiple names to our Savior, the Lord Jesus. Think about the song, His Name is Wonderful. That's a name. Wonderful. He is the mighty King. Master of everything. We're taught that He's the Good Shepherd. That song reminds us that He's the Rock of all ages. Almighty God. I think likely Paul was thinking of Isaiah chapter 45. You read Isaiah chapter 45 three times over, we read these words, I am the Lord, I am Yahweh, I am Jehovah, there is no other. Isaiah goes on to write about God, and there is no other God besides me. And righteous God and a Savior, turn to me and be saved. All the ends of the earth are in God, and there is no other. I think sometimes as believers we are tempted to like the picture of the New Testament Jesus as opposed to the Old Testament God. Sometimes we feel like the Old Testament God is far behind us. Jesus is kind of cuddly and nice. But the truth of the matter is that Jesus has been given a name that is above every name. He is the Lord. Understand, the Old Testament God, the New Testament Jesus, they are one in the same. A name that is above everything. Sure, here people just use the name of Jesus like it just comes right out of the mouth, like an icon, as an exclamation. Sometimes we hear it so much it doesn't really even bother. We hardly even pay attention. Listen to this step up for the Lord Jesus, the one who came down, down, down. So at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven or above and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. Can you imagine that day? There's a day coming when the name Jesus will be sounded in every knee. Not some knees, not most knees. Even those of us with bad knees. The Bible says every knee will bow. In heaven, the angelic beings are going to hear the name Jesus and drop to their knees. On earth, sometimes I'm saying there is a value of life. I hope you do. I hope you are even now willing to bend your knee and confess with your tongue. You also realize that there will be people who will drop to their knees and confess with their tongue that will do so with warning and with shame. Because they'll know it to be true. But it won't be too late. But will they confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father? By the way, that's a fulfillment of Isaiah chapter 45, verse 25. I swore by myself, the word is going to go forth from my mouth in righteousness. And it must not turn back. That to me, every man will bow, and every tongue will swear. So I wonder this morning, has your heart been stirred by the excellencies of Him who has called you out of darkness into His marvelous light? We have to think about the steps of Jesus. He stepped down. He emptied Himself. He humbled Himself. He came as a servant. He took the likeness of a man. You want to know why? For one reason, so he could die. We have the elements of communion. The bread is a picture of His body. He had a human body. He had that human body so that He could die. That's how long He was living to step. Jesus said to His disciples, lest you forget, take this bread. And when you do, you'll be proclaiming my death. You'll be remembering your life that does for you. Dear Lord, we give thanks for bread.
Father, we come here this morning. Sending your Son, who was willing to humble Himself even to the point of death. Father, as we take this bread, may you bring in our hearts the reality of what you did for us that day and kept your broken body to redeem us. Thank you, Jesus.
This morning we've talked about the steps of Jesus. Let's proclaim His death today. Jesus stepped down. His humiliation, His willing to humble Himself, led to His obedience. His obedience led the Father to exalt Him. Not just exalt Him, but to find Him. Exalt Him. He's not in the tomb in the Middle East. He's not here. The angel said He is risen. He's ascended. He's been crowned the King of all things. He ever lives to make intercession for you and for me. He serves as our great high priest. But Hebrews talks about the fact that He is a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. And He has shed His precious blood once for all. And God is satisfied. Jesus said this cup represents His blood. The blood of the new covenant. And again, when we take it, we will be proclaiming His death until it comes. And someday, every creature is going to hear the name of Jesus if you don't deny it. It doesn't matter how stiff-necked and rebellious moving into their they wouldn't die. They wouldn't be this. Aren't you glad that we don't have to wait for something? I'm grateful.